Hello and welcome to our webinar, The Basics of Immunoprecipitation. In the next 25 minutes or so, I will walk you through the basic steps of an IP experiment, and I hope you find some information there that enable you to optimize your results in the lab. First of all, what is an immunoprecipitation or short IP? So in an immunoprecipitation, you are able to isolate a protein of interest out of a complex protein extract by using an antibody that specifically binds to the protein of interest. The antibody is shown here in orange, and it is coupled to a matrix. These are these gray spheres, and your protein of interest, shown as the green spots here in your complex protein mixture, is bound by the antibody, and therefore it can be precipitated out of this complex mixture. And usually it's not only the protein of interest that is precipitated, but also its interaction partners. And in most of the cases, it's the interaction partners that you are interested in. And by immobilizing the protein of interest on the bead, you can wash away all unbound proteins and lipids. So in total, you can summarize an immunoprecipitation in six different steps. First of all, you need to select the right antibody and the right matrix. And I will come to that in a minute. Then you have to prepare your cell lysate. You have to bind your protein of interest to the antibody, and then you have to wash away unbound molecules. And then you might want to elute your protein of interest off the bead, and in the end you want to analyze the protein of interest, maybe by SDS page and Western blotting, but also by other techniques. So what kind of antibody and what kind of matrix should you choose? And I will start here with the antibody. If possible, you should use an antibody that is very well characterized and validated. So there's a lot of discussions going on in the scientific community on the importance of the antibody validation. And what is definitely true is the better you know your antibody, the better you understand your results, which you achieve by using this antibody. So, of course, it should also be tested for immunoprecipitation so that it works in this application. If you order an antibody in a catalog, it often says validated for the following applications, and you should maybe check whether it is validated for IP as well. The affinity of the antibody should be rather high. So the higher the affinity is, the more effectively it can pull down your protein of interest out of the solution. So here, mid nanomolar to low nanomolar affinity would be rather good. And the antibody should be purified, of course, and ideally it should also be pre-absorbed against the antigen. The antibody could be monoclonal, but this is not really a must. You can also do IPs with polyclonal antibodies, of course. In some cases, polyclonal antibodies might even be beneficial. For example, if you do chromatin IPs, I would rather recommend polyclonal antibodies instead of monoclonal. But this really depends on your experiment. So if you're working with a recombinant antigen that carries a tag, then you can also use an antibody directed against the tag, such as GP tag, FLAG tag, MUC tag, others. which might work even better in IP than the antibody against the protein of interest. Or sometimes you don't even have an antibody against the protein of interest itself, then you have to rely on an anti-tag antibody. I'm coming now to the matrix selection for your pull-down experiment. So on this slide, I think the three most commonly used matrices are listed. These are agarose beads, magnetic agarose beads, or dyna beads. If you want to use a centrifuge for the separation of your matrix from the cell extract, then you can use agarose beads. They have the advantage that they have a very high binding capacity because they are porous particles, so the surface of the agarose bead is very high, very, very large, and therefore they can also bind rather a lot of proteins of interest. The same is true for magnetic agarose, but here you simply use a magnet for pulling down the beads out of the protein mixture. And you can also use dyna beads here with a magnet. However, please keep in mind that the dyna beads are not porous particles, but solids, and therefore they don't have such a large surface, and therefore the binding capacity is lower than for magnetic agarose or agarose. So how is the antibody coupled to the beads? And also here, there are different options, many options. Three of them are listed here. The first two options rely on protein A or protein G beads. These are beads that carry protein A or protein Gs on their surface, and this is a protein that binds to the Fc part of immune globulins. Most immune globulins, I have to say, unfortunately not to all immunoglobulins. So you can just use these beads, add your antibody, and then you can basically start your pull down. You might want to cross-link antibody on the protein the A or protein G beads, but this is not necessary in all of the cases. However, you can also use beads that do not have protein A or protein G. You can just covalently link your antibody directly on the beads. And there are several beads with several coupling chemistries commercially available. You have to choose your coupling chemistry and chemically couple your antibody to the beads. As this can be tricky and also is a little bit time consuming, and you might have to play around with the conditions, you can also rely on many prefabricated beads here that already are ready to use, and you can use them directly in your pull down experiment. So now I'm coming to the preparation of the cell lysate. And I can't give any general rules here because this really depends very much on the model organism you're working with. If you work with plants, it will be completely different than compared to preparation of mammalian cell lysate or yeast or bacteria. So this really depends on the type of cells or tissue you are working with. Maybe some very general remarks here. If you use mammalian cells, you can use maybe 1 million to 10 million cells per IP reaction. And in this case, you add your lysis buffer to the cells. You can pipette the lysis buffer up and down, and this might be already sufficient to crack the cells and release the cytosol and all the components of the cell. then you centrifuge it down and you use the supernatant for your IP experiment. In total, you should maybe use 500 micrograms of total protein in your cell extract per IP for mammalian cells, but this can really vary. If you have work with very low abundant proteins, you might need to go higher here. You have to play around here a little bit. When it comes to cell extracts from plants, you might need more material, up to 10 grams of plant material. And here you have to crack the cell wall, and usually this is done by grinding the plant material in liquid nitrogen before you add the lysis buffer and you can do the actual lysis. So as I said, this really depends on what model organism you are working with. Okay, a few words for the right lysis buffer. So a standard lysis buffer for a cytoplasmic protein might be a simple Tris buffer with sodium chloride, EDTA, and a detergent such as non-iodated P40 and P40. If you work on nuclear proteins and you also have to crack the nuclear membrane, you might want to use a harsher buffer. So a very common buffer here would be the REPA buffer, which contains additional detergent in the buffer. And in almost all cases, you might want to add additional supplements to your buffer, and this really depends on your protein of interest. So probably in most of the cases, adding protease inhibitors would be a good idea to keep your protein happy. You might want to digest DNA that is present in your sample, so you use DNAs, one or other nucleases to degrade DNA and RNA. You might want to use additional detergents, chaotropic substances such as urea. You might want to add glycerol or also reducing agents such as DTT or TSEP to keep cysteines in the reduced form. Okay, the next step in your IP would be the binding. And here, please keep in mind that you don't do this overnight or for a very long time. So if you're using a good antibody, then 1 hour should be really sufficient to do this binding step. If you do longer binding steps, you might risk unspecific binding of other proteins and also protein degradation. So don't do this too long. Maybe 1 hour should be enough. It's important during the binding to keep the beads in suspension. So you can do this, for example, by slow rotation on a rotating wheel. Please avoid settling of the beads. So the beads have to be in contact with the lysate. They should not settle down. And you should also avoid rigid shaking or so, because this means mechanical stress and this may damage both the beads and the protein. Therefore, do it gently, slowly, but keep the beads in suspension. For a standard IP, we would recommend using volumes between 200 and 500 microliters, because with these volumes you can ensure in a standard 1.5 milliliter Eppendorf tube that the beads can be kept in suspension and that the mixing occurs quite gently. It's important to do the binding step at 4 degrees centigrade for the sake of your protein. And please avoid incubation at room temperature. And when it comes to the binding buffer, please use a mild buffer. Your protein of interest should feel happy in this buffer, so don't use very harsh conditions during the binding step. When it comes to washing, this might be a little bit different. So here you can use harsher conditions, and the washing step is maybe one of the most crucial steps when it comes to optimizing your IP results. So here you can play around and try to get a very specific IP with low background. But if you are too harsh, you might risk that your protein of interest is washed away as well. So the optimal conditions have to be found here very have to be found here very carefully. So which parameters you should keep an eye on is shown here on this slide. Use a buffer that is harsher than the binding buffer. For example, it might contain detergents or it might contain higher salt concentrations. In this case, if you use harsher conditions, you reduce the unspecific binding. So how should you do the washing? So, as a rule of thumb, I would recommend to use short washing steps, but multiple washing steps and small volumes. So it is more effective to wash maybe three times for a few minutes than one time for an hour. If you wash too long, you also have, again, problems. You might have problems with degradation. So therefore, keep your washing short, but make sure to change your washing buffer multiple times. Okay, now I'm coming to the elution of your protein of interest of the beef. Please keep in mind that there are quite some applications where you don't need to elute from the beef. For example, if you are working on an enzyme and you want to test the enzymatic activity, you can, in most of the cases, you can do this on the beef and you don't have to elute the enzyme from the beef. However, if you want to check whether you have really enriched for your protein of interest and you want to do an SDS page investment plot, of course you have to elute. You can simply do this by adding two times SDS sample buffer, Lemley buffer basically. Please keep in mind that the Lemley buffer not only denatures your protein of interest, but also the antibody, so you will also find the antibody bands on your gel. If you choose an acidic elution shown down here, then you might want to use a glycine buffer pH 2.5. Also in this case, the protein of interest and the antibody will come off the beads. And if you want to keep your protein of interest active, please make sure to immediately neutralize your eluate after the elution and shift it to a neutral pH or to a pH in which your protein of interest feels happy. A very elegant method of elution is the proteolytic elution. You can do that if you have a protein cleavage site introduced between your affinity tag and the protein of interest. A very common protease cleavage site would be a TEF site, a TEF protease site. You can also use thrombin or other specific proteases. In that case, you can simply chop off your protein of interest off the beads by adding the protease. And your protein of interest will be released in the supernatant. And if you want to get rid of the protease again, make sure to use a protease with a his tag or with another affinity tag that can be pulled out of the supernatant. And in the end, you have your pure protein of interest. So actually, you are already finished with your IP experiment, but now you want to analyze your results. So you have to choose between different downstream applications, so depending on what you want to see or what you want to do. In almost all of the cases, you might want to use SDS page embeddedness blotting to check whether you have enriched for your protein of interest and whether there's a lot of background and so on. You can do this by Western blotting. Other downstream applications that are very common would be mass spectrometry and also, as I already mentioned, on-beat enzymatic assays if you are working with enzymes, for example. I would like to talk a little bit about the right controls and how you should analyze your IP by SDS page and Western blot. So it's always important to include the right controls in your experiment. So if you run an SDS page and Western blot, please make sure not to load only the protein that is bound to your beads, which is shown here on the right hand lane, but also include an input lane and a flow through lane. So the input is an aliquot of your cell extract before you added the antibody, and the flow through is your cell extract after you performed the pull down, the IP. So of course there you see a lot of protein bands, and it might look very busy here, and your bound lane, in this case you have only one band for your protein of interest, so it's very clean. But what you also see here on the HL is the antibody heavy chain and the antibody light chain of your IgG that comes off the beads when you boil the beads in Lamley buffer. If you look at a Western blot of a pull down of an IP experiment, that is shown below here. So here you find your protein in the input lane, which is nice. You see that it's somewhat depleted in the flow through lane, but it's still present. So there's still protein around, and you see a nice enrichment on your bead, which is what you want to see actually. So talking about controls, I would like to mention that these are not the only controls you should run on an SDS page in a Western blot. Please make sure to include also controls already during the actual IP. So you might want to use binding controls, which are beads without an antibody. So in that case, if you do a pull down in parallel to your actual experiment with the beads without an antibody, you see what background sticks to your beads without the antibody. That might be useful. What is even more important, in my opinion, is doing pulldowns with mock lysate. So doing your pulldown with cell lysate that does not contain your protein of interest. So if you work with a recombinant cell line which expresses your protein of interest, you probably also have the parental cell line that lacks your protein of interest. So please prepare cell lysates of both cell lines and do the pull down with both cell extracts. The bands you will find in both experiments will probably be not specific. So that's a very nice control as well. I'd like to spend my last two slides on nanobodies and IPs with nanobodies, because nanobodies are very well suited for immunoprecipitation, and I will tell you why in a second. First of all, I'd like to explain what is a nanobody. So actually, what you see here on the slide is a conventional IgG antibody that is very common to most species, and it is composed of two heavy chains in this dark orange color and two light chains in this brighter color. And please keep in mind that the antigen binding sites here are composed of both heavy chains and light chains. So for antigen binding units, both chains, heavy and light chains. In addition to these conventional IgG antibodies, camelids produce so-called heavy chain antibodies. Camelids are llamas, alpacas, dromedaries, camels, and they possess heavy chain antibodies, which are simpler in structure. So they are completely lacking the light chain. And if you look closely, you see that they are also lacking the CH1 domain of the heavy chain. So the heavy chain is shorter than in a conventional IgG. The nanobodies or VHH fragments shown in green here are the antigen binding domains of heavy chain antibodies. And they are very small, only 15 kilodaltons, and very robust and stable. And they can be tethered covalently, conjugated covalently to beads, agarose beads, magnetic agarose beads, or dynabeads, and used for immunoprecipitation. And what's the advantage of doing an IP with a nanobody? And this is shown in the next slide. So what is shown here is a comparison of an immunoprecipitation against green fluorescent protein, GFP, using either the GFP trap that is sold by ChromoTech or a conventional IgG antibody. You see here, again, the input, the flow through, and the bound lane, both for the GFP trap, the nanobody, and for the conventional antibody. What is quite striking here is, in this case, you see a very clean result. There's no interacting partners. You see only one band. And this is true both for the GFP trap and for the IgG. But what you can see here is that you have clearly heavy chain and light chain contamination in the conventional pull-down with conventional antibody. You don't have only the GFP band, but also these additional bands. So you get very nice, very clean results with the GFP trap. And since the nanobody is so robust, you can really use harsh washing conditions quite a variety of different pH ranges and detergents and so on. So it's very easy to handle. It's ready to use, and you can find it on our web page. I'd like to mention that we don't have only GFP traps, but also other traps against RFP, against other tags. Please check our website for details, and also for the publications that are using GFP traps. There's a list on our website as well. And with that, I'm already at the end of my talk. Thank you very much for listening. And good luck with your experiment.
Even though I'm familiar with immunoprecipitation, I definitely got some new input. We have already received a number of questions regarding the webinar, and here is the first one. I have an antibody against my protein of interest, but I could also use an antibody against the tag. My protein of interest is GFP tagged. How should I conduct the immunoprecipitation?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so actually, if you know that the antibody against the protein of interest works in IP, you can use that antibody, but of course you can also use a GFP antibody, and there's many very good GFP antibodies around, so actually you can do both. If you are not sure, I would recommend to use antibody against GFP, such as the GFP trap maybe, and use your antibody against the protein of interest for detection in Western blotting in the end. So do the pull down with one antibody and the detection with the other one. This could maybe help to avoid artifacts in the detection.
Very good. Here comes a second one, which is related to the first one. Where do I find information about validation of antibodies?
Mm-hmm. So as a first source of information, I would always go to the supplier's website and check what information I get there. Many suppliers write for their antibodies for which application they are validated for. For example, tested for IP or similar like that. So if you are using an antibody that is you have from a publication that is published for IP, it should be possible to use these antibodies too. And to make sure whether you're using the same antibody than in the publication, I would recommend to check the RRID code, the research reagent ID. So with that ID, you can make sure that you're using actually the same antibody. And you might also want to check the CiteAB portal. Here, many antibodies and applications are listed too.
Very good. Now we are coming to the lysis step. There are two more questions here. The first one is, which lysis buffer should I use? I don't think I have a special protein.
Okay. I would ask what is a special protein, but okay, for mammalian cells, if it's a mammalian protein, as I mentioned, the lysis buffer really doesn't have to be too complicated. I would just use the standard lysis buffer that was mentioned in one of the slides. There's already detergent in it, which also helps to keep the protein of interest soluble. You can also use Reaper buffer, but please keep in mind if you do so, this is a harsher buffer with more detergent and is more suited for the extraction of nuclear proteins than the standard lysis buffers. Please try to keep your lysis buffer as simple as possible, but as stringent or as harsh as needed.
Okay, very good. Here's the next question. Can I use a sample volume of larger than 500 microliters?
Well, that's a standard volume, but yes, of course, it's possible to use larger volumes. For example, I mentioned plant research. Then you might often exceed these 500 microliters of cell lysate, and you might have to use several milliliters. So this is possible to do so if your antibody has an affinity that is high enough to bind the protein of interest tightly, then you should not have any problems with higher volumes, larger volumes. If you have a weak antibody, you might run into difficulties here. So that might either result in an inefficient IP, it might not be possible to do so many washing steps or so. So if possible, in that case, if you have a weak antibody, decrease the total volume of your IP.
Very good. One of the questions I'm also interested in is, why should I avoid overnight incubation?
Mm-hmm. So again, if you use an antibody with a decent affinity, overnight incubation is not necessary because after 1 hour you should have pulled down your protein of interest in large amounts. So that's one thing, and the other thing is the longer you incubate, the higher is the risk to get more background, more unspecific binding to the beads, and also the probability is higher that your protein is degraded during this step. So therefore, I would try to keep the incubation time by 1 hour. Yeah.
Okay, very good. Another scientist asks, when should I use Dynabeads? When magnetic agarose beads?
Yeah, so I think there's many many proteins where you can use both. I mentioned in my talk that the agarose beads have a higher binding capacity. However, there are examples when agarose beads won't work that well than diner beads, and this is one example for this is if you work with large protein complexes that are too large to diffuse into the pores of the magnetic agarose, then you might be better if you your experiments might be work better if you use the diner beads, which is a non-porous material. So here I would prefer diner beads.
Okay. The next question is a troubleshooting question. I cannot detect my protein on Western blot. What should I do?
Okay.
Very good question.
There's a lot of reasons why this can happen. Yeah, so maybe one reason would be that your protein of interest is present in very low abundance. So you can try to load more of the sample on the SDS page and on your Western blot basically. Or another reason might be that your protein of interest is not precipitated very well by your antibody. So what I would definitely check is in the Western blot if you see your if you can detect your protein of interest in the input lane. If no, your protein of interest might not be expressed or it's present in such a low abundance that you can't detect it by the with an antibody. And if you see it in the input lane, then you should check whether you see it in the flow through as well. If yes, then it hasn't really bound to the beads during the immunoprecipitation. Yeah. But of course, there's also other reasons like secondary antibodies and things like that. But these would be the reasons I would that come to my mind when I think the IP hasn't worked. Maybe. Yeah.
Okay, very good. So the next question is, which immobilization strategy is the best?
Okay. Immobilization strategy, I think what is meant by that is the immobilization of the antibody to the beads or to the matrix. So I mentioned three different methods basically, or three different strategies. I would say if you have protein A beads and an antibody that binds to the protein A beads, this is a very simple and straightforward thing. You just mix your antibody with the protein A beads, and then you can start your IP. This might be a problem if you work with very harsh buffers, then you might get into trouble here. So in that case, I would rather recommend a covalent linking of the antibody to the beads. However, this is a step that takes time, so and you might have to optimize the step as well. So if you have the possibility to use ready-to-use beads such as nanotraps, then that's maybe the easiest, and you should get rather clean results here and no inconsistencies.
Okay, so last question I think now is which assays can be performed on beet. I usually elute my protein of interest, but maybe it's not needed every time.
Yeah, that's true. So what was mentioned in the talk was that for maybe enzymatic assays, it's not necessary if you know that your enzyme is present on the beads and you want to test its activity. It might be a good idea to do this on beads and not stress the enzyme by eluting it from the beads. This is definitely worth testing. Another example where you don't have to elute would be mass spectrometry, maybe. So if you're interested in what proteins are bound to the beads and also to the protein of interest, so what interaction partners do I have, you can maybe perform a proteolytic digest directly on the beads, and you don't have to elute it from the beads, and you just take it from there. That would be another example that comes to my mind. Of course, if you need to do a Westerblot or SDS page analysis, of course you have to elute it with sample buffer. Yeah.
Okay. So I think we have to stop now. Most questions have been answered. For all questions not yet answered, we will send you an email including the answers. Thank you all for your participation and the very interesting questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Christoph.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.